I wanted to devote this lecture and the next to the idea of weak measurement in quantum mechanics. The idea of weak, if probably the measurement should be in quotes, as we'll see, but it's usually written without quotes. The idea of weak measurement was first explicitly introduced by Aharonov, Elbert, and Weidman in a paper in 1988 in the context of pre- and post-selected ensembles, which you remember we talked about last time. However, nowadays, in practice, it's much more often used without post-selection. And I think one could, in fact, I think claim that in some sense, experimentalists have for many years been using the idea of weak measurement without post-selection, without really writing it down explicitly. In that context, it's most often applied to mesoscopic systems, and particularly sustained bit of work, piece of work on that. The question of weak measurement, weak continuous measurement in mesoscopic systems has been done by Korotkov and various co-workers, and I'll talk about that in the next lecture. In the present lecture, I'm going to be mostly talking about weak measurement in the context of pre- and post-selection. Let's just think for a moment about what we mean by measurement in general. Well, I suppose in the vaguest and most general sense, you mean some kind of operation by which you couple a microscopic system. I'm thinking now, because in terms of the kinds of systems we normally use quantum mechanics for, we couple some microsystem, S, to a macroscopic system, which we can call a measuring apparatus, let's call it M, and you try to infer at least something about the behavior of the microsystem from the behavior of the measuring apparatus, which you can directly inspect. So the general philosophy is that you can't inspect the microsystem, the atom, electron, neutron, whatever, directly, but what you do is to try to rig up a device which will enable you to inspect the final state of the measuring apparatus. And from that, infer at least something about the behavior of the microsystem. Now, I think the argument starts when you ask, okay, how much do you need to be able to infer about the microsystem before it counts as a real measurement? And as you'll see, in the context of weak measurement, that's a highly debated point. Let's start off with the very old concept of measurement, often called projective measurement, due to von Neumann. Now, I want to distinguish carefully in this lecture between von Neumann measurements and the von Neumann model. So von Neumann gave, first of all, a general scheme for setting up, as it were, a measuring apparatus, and he then gave a very particular model of how one might do that. So I'm going to distinguish those two, and I think that is important. I think there has been a tendency in the literature to take the von Neumann model as essentially defining von Neumann measurement, which is I think, not right. So in the von Neumann approach to measurement, you need to be able to read off the value of some specific variable A of your microsystem S uniquely from the final state of the measuring apparatus after the two have interacted. Now, notice we do want to be able to read off the value of a specific variable A for a specific microsystem, right? For each one of the ensemble of neutrons, atoms, or whatever. So what does that mean? Well, let's suppose that you have an ensemble such that each of its members is known to be in an eigenstate of the measured quantity A. In other words, that equation is satisfied. Then what you need is that if the initial state of M sub A is x sub 0, and the initial state, as we've specified, of the microsystem, a particular microsystem, is phi sub I, then after the measurement, the microsystem will in general be in a different state. Remember that the case in which the microsystem remains in the same state after measurement is called an ideal measurement. And in real life, ideal measurements are actually rather few and far between. And let me again remind you of the case, the sort of typical case is that of a photon, where you might be measuring it, say its polarization. In the measurement, the photon disappears, so it's certainly not in the same state after the measurement at all. And in fact, strictly speaking, the notation should be generalized for that. But anyway, that's not the important point. The important point is that the macrosystem ends up, the measuring apparatus ends up in some macrostate x sub I, and it's essential, if it's going to function as a good von Neumann measuring apparatus, so it's essential that the states of the macrosystem, the measuring apparatus, corresponding to different values of I here, should be mutually distinguishable. So a typical example would be you have, you're measuring something on a, let's say, say the polarization on a photon. Let's say if the photon has polarization vertical, then it will pass a particular beam splitter, polarizing beam splitter, and will be recorded in a detector, say D1. If it's got the opposite polarization, it may be reflected, detected in a different detector. In this case, the two detectors combined form the measuring apparatus, and it's clear that you can distinguish a click in one from a click in the other. So what does that imply for the quantum mechanical description of the measuring apparatus? Well, in the most naive way, it implies that the measuring apparatus starts in a particular quantum state, psi sub zero, say, and as a result of the interaction with the system given by the unitary evolution operator U, it should end up in a state psi sub I, in general different from psi sub zero, although in a particular case, one of the I's could, of course, be equal to zero. What's really important here, though, is that the different states of the apparatus should be orthogonal, and moreover, I mean, this is not something one can easily express in quantum mechanical notation, but moreover, they should be distinguishable, as it were, with the naked eye, or with the naked ear, whatever. So, crudely speaking, they should be macroscopically distinct. The concept of macroscopically distinct actually turns out to be rather a tricky one, and we'll have to come back to it later in the course, but for the moment, let's take it as given. Well, now, of course, that's a bit too naive, because almost certainly in real life, your measuring apparatus is a macroscopic object. It doesn't start in a particular quantum state. It has to be described by some kind of density matrix. So the generalization is simply that you start off with a description of the system and the measuring apparatus. The system is now described by it is described by a density matrix, but this is just given by the pure state phi I here. The measuring apparatus, in general, starts off in a non-trivial mixture, and after the event, you've got some other density matrix for your system, and you've got a different density matrix for your apparatus, and what corresponds, crudely speaking, to this condition of the mixture is that the trace of rho I times rho j should be delta ij. For an ideal measurement, well, obviously sigma prime I is just sigma I, but as I say, in general, that's not the typical case. Okay, so far so good. That's all von Neumann. Way back in 1930 or thereabouts. Now, as I said, that was his general scheme for measurement, and that, of course, defines what we normally call a projective measurement. However, von Neumann did introduce a particular model which implements this scheme. And I think probably his inspiration for that was the stage in a Stern-Gerlach measurement where you actually correlate the spin of the particle which you want to measure with its orbital coordinates in such a way that it's deflected differently depending on whether it's up or down. So that's notice incidentally that that's only part of the in a Stern-Gerlach apparatus. That's only part of the apparatus. You've still got to have some kind of detector to see whether a given particle came out in one beam or the other. But I think this was the bit that von Neumann was probably inspired by. So we model the measuring apparatus by a single variable p with psi zero of p strongly peaked around some variable p zero. So in the case of the Stern-Gerlach apparatus, your momentum in the vertical direction would be strongly peaked around some value, let's say zero. And suppose that the variable, which is conjugate to p, is q, then von Neumann model, you write the system apparatus interaction in this form here. It's simply the operator of the variable you want to measure, A, times Q, and the sum interaction interaction function here, G of T, which is strongly impulsive. That is, it's strongly peaked around a given time. So in the Stern-Gerlach measurement, for example, the interaction of the spin with the magnetic field gradient would really be confined to the time when it's passing here. So what's important here is that the length of time over which the interaction is substantial is small compared to the characteristic time inverse frequency of motion of either the system or the measuring apparatus. So you call that an impulsive approximation. And then, to a good approximation, you can write the evolution operator. Well, in general, it involves the whole Hamiltonian, but the dominant part is now this. And so, to a good approximation, you can just write it as this. This then gives you this expression here. But Q, remember, is the variable which is conjugate to P. So this acts to shift the value of P. So if the initial state of the system, an eigenstate of A, in other words, if this equation is satisfied, then the evolution operator acting on that gives you this, but that is this simply gives you a shift of G0 times AI, and so you get this result here. In other words, the system ends up in the same state as it was before the measurement interaction, but the measuring apparatus has now shifted into a different state from its original one. What's essential here is that we should be able to read off unambiguously the value of AI, and that what that requires then is that the final states of the measuring apparatus corresponding to different values of AI should be well separated. In particular, this, it means that the initial spread in P, delta P0 here, should be small compared to the difference in the mean value of P induced by the the interaction. Okay. So that's the phenomenon model of measurement, which, as I emphasize again, that's merely one implementation of his more general scheme of measurement. Okay, any questions or comments before I go on? I say, well, that's a pretty old hat, I guess, but we need it to make the contrast. Okay, so now let's come to the definition of weak measurement, and so I prefer to put the measurement in quotes here. Suppose we assume, as in the original phenomenon scheme, that we get a transition of this type. But now, however, let's postulate that the final states of the measuring apparatus are very little different depending on the value of I. In other words, this overlap is 1 minus epsilon ij, where epsilon ij is much less than 1. In other words, the final state of the measuring device, of different final states are very strongly overlapping. So, well, in quantum mechanical language, what that means is that unitary evolution still gives you this, but now psi I times psi j, the overlap of psi I and psi j is close to 1. So again, we could try to implement this within the von Neumann model, Stern-Gerlach-like model. As previously, we could have an interaction, Hamiltonian, which is this. We have this should be G0, I guess, not 1, I don't know, what's the 1 there. And we still have an impulsive condition. However, the difference now is that the overlap of the two final states is very close to 1. In other words, that now the initial width of the state of the measuring apparatus should be large compared to the difference induced by interaction with the system. Now, it's clear that in some sense, at least, this is a very bad measuring instrument. We can essentially infer nothing about individual systems of the ensemble. However, if we measure the expectation value of an appropriate operator omega, in this case it would simply be p, I guess, on the ensemble of devices, then we might be able to infer the average value of A for the ensemble of systems. So if we're doing a Stern-Gerlach-like measurement, then we would measure the expectation value of P, and that over a large number of cases, as it were, over the ensemble. Incidentally, this is the principle. It's this result which is the principle which is essentially used when we use weak measurement experimentally without post-selection. Well, should you count, whether or not you engage in post-selection, should you actually count this operation as measurement? Well, that may be a matter of terminology, but I think some of the apparently paradoxical features which come out when we consider pre- and post-selected ensembles do look less paradoxical if you adopt the view that what you're this is not really telling you anything about an individual system of the ensemble. It's telling you about the reaction of the measuring apparatus to the system, but since this is not a very good measuring apparatus, you know, you haven't really inferred a value of anything. One can argue about that, and in fact, I actually put in a comment, and later Asher Peres also put in a comment immediately following the original AAV paper, and we got a response, and the debate in some sense continues. But it may to some extent be just a matter of terminology. Now, so far, the idea of weak measurement doesn't seem to be particularly exciting, but what Aharonov, Albert and Weinmann in their paper showed is that there are some quite interesting results if you combine weak measurement with pre- and post-selection. Suppose the system starts off in some state, phi, is not an eigenfunction of the operator you're trying to measure. And the device, M sub A, let's for definiteness, for simplicity, have it starting in a pure state, psi sub zero, although, that, of course, that's not really terribly realistic. We can, as usual, we expand phi in the eigenfunctions of A, in this way here. And then, by linearity, irrespective of the strength of the interaction, the final state is now going to be converted into this state here. That's the final state of the universe, and you see that now it's entangled between the system and the measuring apparatus, and of course it's precisely this kind of final state which leads to all the problems, the so-called measurement paradox, so forth, which we'll come to in detail later. At the moment, let's assume that we've got this wave function here. And now let's post-select by measuring on S some operator D whose eigenstates include neither phi nor the phi sub I. And let's keep only those cases in which we find a particular eigenvalue of D, let's say, corresponding to an eigenfunction chi. So we're going to post-select the sub-ensemble where the final value of D turns out to be the particular value we want. And now, another question arises. What's the correct description of the sub-ensemble of devices which have interacted with the systems which we selected in this way? Well, let's apply the generalized projection postulate to the state of the universe, that is, the combination of the system and the measuring apparatus. The state of the universe so obtained should be the projection onto state chi of the microsystem times the original state of the universe, which is simply this times the projection, the overlap of chi and phi. But you remember that chi only refers to the system and phi refers to both the system and the measuring apparatus. So that's given by this overlap here. Now, if we expand chi in the eigenfunctions of A, that is, we write this expression here, then the final state of the sub-ensemble of devices is given by this expression here. Where you remember, the different psi I in general are not mutually orthogonal. All of this, of course, would be true whether we have a weak or a strong measurement, but the difference is that in the case of weak measurement, the psi sub i's are in general not mutually orthogonal. Now let's consider the measurement of some operator omega of the device measured on this state. If we take into account normalization, then we find that it's given by this expression here. And now what's interesting, you see, is that now you actually have amplitudes coming in the in the cross terms, provided that that's, this equation is fulfilled. In other words, the psi I and psi j essentially should not be mutually orthogonal, so your measurement should not be von Neumann, but it need not be weak. You still get this result. So in this, so quite generally, irrespective of whether we're talking about a weak, a strong, or intermediate strength measurement, if we have pre and post selection, then the expectation value of our operator omega is going to be given by an expression of this type. Well, okay, so what? Well, now let's take the limit of weak interaction and now suppose, make a very rather specific assumption, which is essentially an invocation of the von Neumann model at this point, or a slight generalization of it. We assume that the final state of the measuring apparatus is its initial state plus some kind of shift which is proportional to A sub I. Now, let me emphasize, that's a very specific assumption. It might well not hold in many cases, even many cases of so-called weak measurement. But it does hold in the original von Neumann model, and you can think of this as a slight generalization of it. Then, to linear order in the small quantity epsilon here, we have this result here, which we can now rewrite as this. It's convenient to just rewrite this expression in this way here. You see what's peculiar about this expression. You see, let's see. We cancelled to get from here to here. You see, we cancelled an amplitude type term in the top with one of the amplitudes which occur in the bottom. So we now have an amplitude sitting on the bottom here. And this amplitude is simply the overlap of phi and chi. Remember that ci was the expansion of the initial state in the eigenfunctions of the quantity you want to measure, and di was the coefficient in the expansion of the final state. So this expression here on the bottom is just phi times chi. And you notice that there's nothing which says that that can't be very small, or perhaps even zero. Now, the case of no post-selection is equivalent to a special case of this expression here with chi equal to phi. If you have no post-selection, then obviously your final ensemble is just equal to your original one. And in that case, since this is just the expectation value, we have an expression for omega which is of this type here. Okay. So if you stare at this expression here and this one here, this is indeed the standard expression for an expectation value. Right? So that suggests a definition which says that the weak expectation value is given by basically the corresponding expression coming from here. That is phi a chi divided by the overlap of phi and chi. And that is the original definition of the weak value of an operator on a pre- and post-selected ensemble, which Aharonov, Albert and Weidman originally gave in their 1988 paper. Now, again, one can argue whether this weak value is actually the value of anything which characterizes the system as distinct from, in some sense, being a very special property of this von Neumann type model. Remember that you only got this because you made this assumption here, which is very specific to the von Neumann model. So one can argue, I guess, as we did back in 1988, about whether this is really telling you anything about measurement in general or not. But anyway, This is the way that they defined it. Okay, any questions? I know there's a lot of somewhat tedious algebra goes into there, and it may not be very easy to follow it at speed, as it were, but if necessary, you can go back to the original papers and convince yourself that, at least within this way of looking at things, as it were, it makes sense to define a weak value in this way. Well, turns out that the weak value, which you define in this way, has some rather peculiar properties. I think if you, I would suggest for the moment that you sort of forget about the details of the intermediate algebra and just concentrate on this on this definition here and see and look to see some of the surprising properties it's going to have. Well, I think the weak value certainly has some very unusual properties, which I think again might lead one to think that it really can't be a value of anything in the standard sense. It may be complex, even though A itself is Hermitian. Again, if you take chi to be the standard plus state, up plus down, normalized, and or 0 plus 1, and phi is the zero state of your qubit, then the expectation value is sigma y. The weak expectation value is then minus I. So it can be complex. More spectacularly, the weak expectation value may lie outside the spectrum of A, in fact, possibly far outside it. For example, again, suppose that chi is the state 0, zero state of your qubit. Phi would be that state rotated through theta, an angle theta, which is nearly pi, so you've nearly gone from the zero state to the one state. Yeah? They're nearly orthogonal. And A is sigma x. This is basically the one we discussed before, just now. Then it turns out that the weak expectation value of sigma x is cotangent of theta over 2, which clearly, as theta tends to pi, tends to infinity. And Aharonov and company exploited this peculiar property in the title of their original paper, which is how the measured value of a spin a half can turn out to be 100, which is the effect. Now, particularly striking example in this respect is the so-called three-box problem. We have three boxes, which and a particle can be in any of those three boxes. And we pre-select a state, which is simply this linear combination, A plus B plus C. A obviously meaning a state which is localized in box O, et cetera, et cetera. And we finally post-select it in a different state, chi, A plus B minus C. And now you notice that there's nothing particularly anomalous about this, and in particular the overlap of the initial and final states is a third. It's not zero. Now, we're going to measure the particle at some intermediate time, or more precisely, we're going to put it into interaction with some measuring device at an intermediate time to see which box it's in. We have to actually specify this rather carefully. The first possibility is to do what I've called a von Neumann measurement. I think I should be a little more careful than that. It's going to be a complete von Neumann measurement, by which I mean that my measuring device is going to respond in macroscopically different ways depending on whether the particle in question is in box A or box B or box C. So in other words, there are going to be three mutually orthogonal and macroscopically distinct outputs of your measuring apparatus. So the result of a measurement, for example, would be that the expectation value of the projector PA, which is the probability of being in box A, would be given by this overlap here. You remember that in the case of von Neumann measurements, what you have to do is basically to calculate the probability that you went from the initial state to the appropriate eigenstate which you want to measure, times the probability that you went from the intermediate state to the final state, and then divide by the total probability of going from the initial state to the final state by any of the intermediate possibilities. Okay, so and that's basically just classical statistics, Bayesian statistics, if you like. Well, in this case, this is a third. This is a third. And the when you add up the denominators, that just also gives you a third. So the probability of finding your system in box A with an intermediate measurement is just a third. And that then, obviously, by symmetry, the probability of finding it in B is a third. And well, you can actually calculate it explicitly, but we'll get it from completeness. The probability of finding it in C is also a third. So absolutely no problem here. It's just the common sense result. Now, however, let's consider a weak so-called measurement. If we consider the weak value of the, again, it's not entirely clear that they're really values, but let's consider the weak expectation value of this operator here. By definition, remember, that's just phi times PA times chi divided by phi times chi. Now, the this probability here, you see, this is just, this is essentially the overlap of phi with the intermediate state times the overlap with the final state, not the probabilities. Remember, the probabilities is the overlap squared, but now you've just got the overlaps themselves. Each of these is 1 over root 3 times 1 over root 3. Remember, what was our usual? Yes, sorry, it's up here. Yeah, you see the projection of phi on A. is just 1 over root 3. The projection of phi on chi is 1 over root 3. And now, the important point to notice is that the overlap of the initial and final states is, well, you've got a plus, plus, minus, so that's just a third again. So you get the answer 1. So this gives you a rather surprising result that if you make a weak so-called measurement and interpret that measurement in terms of probabilities, because this is the delicate point, but if you do interpret it in terms of probabilities, then the probability of finding your system in box A is 1. But alas, everything is clearly symmetric with respect to A and B. So so the probability, this expectation value, again, has to be plus 1. And you can then evaluate P sub C explicitly, and it turns out to be minus 1. Now, that at least is reassuring, because this means that the expectation value of PA plus that of PB plus that of PC is equal to plus 1, and that has to be the case because as an operator identity, this relation is satisfied. Okay? So the expectation value of the sum of these has got to be 1. And so that works out even for this weak measurement situation. But do we have a paradox here? Well, I think not really. It's only a paradox if you regard the weak value as actually telling you a property of the system rather than telling you something about how the measuring apparatus responds to the system. Again, that's something that can be argued backwards and forwards. You might ask, has this actually been verified, this rather peculiar result, been verified experimentally? And the answer is yes. Kevin Resch with Ephraim Steinberg and others did this experiment a few years ago. And they basically, it was not really in some sense a quantum mechanical experiment because they were using lasers, but they used an argument which is very common in this field, that if you've shown that something happens for a classical laser, then it's automatically going to happen for individual photons. And, well, as far as we know, that's right. So they actually did a laser experiment, which essentially verified this behavior. In that case, the output of the so-called measuring apparatus was a transverse deflection of a beam of photons, and they rigged up an appropriate device with three different ports to. However, I said it's only paradoxical if we take the weak value to be a property of S rather than FMA, and there seems in this situation there seems no particularly good reason to do it. But there is actually a rather more subtle point which comes up, and I'll postpone this for a minute, but come back to this at the end of this lecture. Yeah.
So the assumption of having a weak measurement, is that all right? I mean, the difference between initial state and final state is not very smaller than one,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
So is that a proper assumption here to consider this a weak measurement?
Well, a proper assumption, do you mean for, are you thinking of a particular experimental setup or?
No, I mean, what you wrote for weak measurement,
yes,
assumption was that the projection of the initial state and final state would be 1 minus epsilon ij, right?
Well, it's not so much the projection of the initial and the final state, but rather the difference in the final state. Yep.
Okay, so it seems that here's, the difference is not very small, right?
Well, no. But I mean, by hypothesis, this is meant to describe an experimental setup where the difference is very small. Right? So, for example, if you're talking about, your weak measurement was of photon polarization, say. We'll actually come to a very similar case in a moment, but it turns out that you start off with in this case, the measuring device is the transverse displacement of your light beam, and you're going to try to affect that by coupling that deflection to the polarization, sorry, by putting it through some kind of or birefringent medium or whatever. Now, if you wanted to get a good measurement, what you'd have to do is to make sure that your birefringent medium split the beams so that the two packets were distinct. For a weak measurement, what you would do is to only have a very small deflection so that the overlap of the beam corresponding to, say, vertical polarization would be nearly 100% with that corresponding to horizontal polarization. So, you can always make these definitions, but the question is, what kind of experimental situation are they supposed to apply to? And that's the kind of situation. Okay. So it does look as if the effect, as it were, is real. Let's try to say a little about how it actually works, as it were. And again, it turns out, I think, a rather instructive, relevant experiment is the experiment of Ritchie et al., done fairly soon after the original suggestion by Aharon and company. Now, again, this was a classical simulation. They're doing it with classical laser beams. But again, one argues that if you could, for practical reasons, you can't do it with single photons and count the photons individually, but one argues that if you could, you'd essentially get the same results. Because in some sense, it turns out that this is not really whether you call it a quantum mechanical phenomenon or not is a matter of words, I suppose. It does have a very strong classical analogue, at least. So let's see how that classical analogue works. So you have, this is roughly what I was saying earlier, you have a laser source which emits a beam whose transverse extension is W sub zero, and that might, I forget what it was in the actual experiment, I suspect of the order of a few tens or hundreds of microns. And now you're going to pass this through a polarizer set with a transmission axis at alpha in the XY plane. And then, so anything that comes through now is going to be polarized at a particular angle in the XY plane. Now you're going to submit it to a birefringent plate, but that plate is going to be such that the deviation of the beam, which will depend, of course, on whether it's horizontal or vertical, that deviation, A, is small compared to the initial width. And what you're then you're going to now post-select by putting the beam through a polarizer set at angle beta. And finally, you're going to measure the distribution, the transverse distribution, on some final screen there. So is that clear what's going on? This is the pre-selection here. Pre-select for a given polarization. You post-select for a different, in general, different polarization, and this is the weak measurement occurring at this point here. You've got an interaction with the measuring device which splits the beam, but by an amount small compared to its original spread. So obviously, in this case, the coordinate of the measuring device is simply the transverse deflection. Okay, now you can actually go through the explicit algebra on this. It's probably not worth trying to follow this in minute detail, but just to show you, as it were, that the formulae exist. At at point one, that's here, the electric field of the beam is, of course, some irrelevant function of time and the other coordinates, but it's basically a Gaussian of this form with respect to the vertical direction, and its actual polarization is along alpha, which gives you this here. The birefringent plate is going to shift the y coordinate so that by the time you get to 2, the shift will be plus or minus a over 2. So at point 2 here, just before it gets to the final post-selection, the field is going to be of this form here. Now you see the x and y components are now behaving somewhat differently. There's an extra phase in here which is a nuisance. It's associated with the possible different path lengths, and you have to eventually get rid of it. But in general, it does occur. And finally, at point 3, the thing has now got through the post-selection. So that means that the polarization is along beta, right, the post-selection value. And now, again, it may be not immediately obvious, but you do a bit of algebra, and you find that the space dependence is again given by these two packets with these functions cos alpha, cos beta, sine alpha, sine beta here. And so the intensity, the square of the field divided by the original one, is given by this expression here. Now you've got these two, the squares of these two terms, obviously, but you also crucially have an interference term between them. This is what's going to cause all the interesting phenomena. You've got this interference term here. Now, you see, if A is small, then basically the spatial indices here are very similar in these three expressions. In fact, if you were to put A equal to 0, it would be 2y squared in each of these expressions. So that has an interesting consequence. Now that's our expression, and so you needn't worry too much about the details of the algebra, how we got there. But the interesting case is when sine alpha is roughly cos alpha, but sine beta is the opposite, is minus cos beta. Sine beta is minus cos beta, yeah. So that would correspond, for example, to alpha equals pi over 4, and beta close to 3 pi over 4. Now, in that case, if you just stare at this expression, you see that this term here is minus these two terms here, which are roughly equal. So it's minus twice that. In other words, if A was 0 now, you'd get complete cancellation. I mean, that of course is nothing at all surprising. If indeed A were 0, then you haven't made any intermediate measurement at all. You've simply passed the thing between nearly crossed polarizers. So it's to be expected that you'd only get a very low transmission. So what now turns out is if you stare at that expression, you get almost complete cancellation by this last term of the first two terms, except for in a very small region. So it turns out the only region where the cancellation is not complete and at the same time I of y is not completely negligible is this region here. In other words, what's happened now is that you started off with this profile of your intensity. And if you just pre and post selected on the same state, then you just get out a curve similar to this. That would be nothing particularly surprising. However, what's happened now is that because of the strong destructive interference, almost all of this curve has been washed out. What you're left with is a very tiny bit, which, however, has been, on average, shifted relative to the original origin here. And it turns out, indeed, that the center, the average value of this packet of y for this packet here is precisely half a cot epsilon, which is precisely the weak value as originally defined. The important point to realize, though, is that you've achieved this result at the cost of having attenuated your original beam by an enormous factor. The factor is something like this, which in the original experiment of Ricci et al. Was something like 10 to the minus 5. So this gives perhaps this classical analog. It really is, I would say, it's in some sense not weak measurement in the original intended sense, but it's a classical analog of weak measurement. The measuring apparatus is the transverse spatial behavior of the beam, just as in a Sturm-Gerlach experiment. The P of the measuring apparatus, the variable which is going to be shifted, is Y. The initial state phi is a beam polarized at angle alpha, and the final state chi is the beam polarized at angle beta. So I think you can see the correspondence there. Again, though, emphasize you've got out an apparently dramatic effect at the cost of having attenuated your beam by an enormous factor. Nevertheless, that doesn't mean it's not useful. And perhaps before I go on, I'll just stop for a moment and ask if there are any questions or comments. Well, I'd say it is useful, and there have been some interesting applications of the idea of weak measurement with post-selection. One interesting application is by my colleague Paul Quiert and a student of his a couple of years ago to measure the so-called spin Hall effect of light. It's an interesting effect in itself, I think. So let me just say a word about it. Let's imagine that you have a circularly polarized photon is incident on the air glass, an air glass interface, and which is transmitted. So let's do this for the moment, at least in quantum terms, although again, as so often, the experiment was actually a classical one using a laser. Let's think of a single photon. It's incident on this air glass interface, and let's suppose it's transmitted. Then the change in the spin angular momentum, it's going to change spin angular momentum, because although its helicity is the same here and here, the k vector has actually shifted as I go from the air into the glass. So the angular momentum then will have changed from h bar in this direction to h bar in this direction. That is h bar k minus, this should be a k prime, I guess, yes, a k prime. Now, assuming that all of this is in free space, as it were, no extra torques around, then the total angular momentum, L cross S, plus S, has to be conserved. And therefore, L must be, the change in S must be compensated by a change in the orbital angular momentum. What does that mean? Well, crudely speaking, if we imagine the initial position of the photon is at y equals 0, then what's going to happen is that you'll get a small displacement, in this case out of the page, and delta L will then be minus h bar k prime cross y. So let me just go through that again for a moment. If you, just suppose the initial spatial position, insofar as you can define it, for the photon was 0 with reference to some origin, let's say this point, then the initial orbital angular momentum as it came in was 0. However, what's going to happen is that it will undergo a slight shift out of the out of the board, as a result of that, it will acquire an angular momentum in the direction required. So this is the change in angular momentum it will get. That then constrains y to be given by this formula here. And then you do a bit of algebra on that, and you find that y is given by this expression here. Now, the interesting point is that lambda, the wavelength of the photon, occurs in that expression. And so y, the small displacement, is going to be less than lambda over 2 pi. And typically that is something like 100 nanometers. I just comment briefly, this argument is slightly oversimplified because of the fact that in general the transmission probability for parallel and, this polarization and this one are going to be different. But that's a complication you can deal with. Now, this means that your the initial transverse spread in y, that's the total width of the wave packet out in this direction here, is going to be huge compared to lambda, since the change in y is less than lambda. That means this is very much a weak measurement kind of situation. So if you didn't nothing else, as it were, it would be very difficult to detect this small transverse displacement. What, however, Hostin and Quirt did is to post-select and then measure I of y and compare with I zero of y. And the prediction is that the I zero of y should be much less than I of y, but shifted by this amount. And this amount, remember, can be very large compared to the original y zero, large compared to lambda over 2 pi. So that experiment did seem to work and did, and they were able to detect this very small effect in this way. This So what they did, is they actually used a classical laser field, coherent state, and they pre-selected on the horizontal polarization. They post-selected on vertical, close to vertical polarization. And this meant that the weak value of sigma z, the helicity, should be plus or minus I over delta. So you get an amplification of delta y by, in this case, by something like four orders of magnitude. So, and that was the only reason they were able to measure this effect at all, in fact. That's one application. A second application, a recent one, is to measure very small beam deflections. Again, I give an over-schematic presentation of this. They call, the team who did this, call the interferometer they use a SAGNAC interferometer. I think in some sense that's a little misleading, because one normally thinks of SAGNAC interferometry as involving rotation. There's no rotation involved, no continuous rotation involved in this experiment. However, the geometrical setup is that of a SAGNAC interferometer. Got a source here at your so-called bright port. Got a beam splitter, 50-50 beam splitter here. The light which goes through can either go this way around or this way around, and what you try to measure is the interference of light which has gone around clockwise and light going around counterclockwise. And of course, in the usual application, the fact that the device is rotating means that the phases are a bit different, and you do get an effect. However, what they did was to try to use this setup to measure very, very small deflections of this of these mirrors here. So when you, if the mirrors are slightly misaligned, you see the beams don't come back together at exactly the same point. In other words, you've got the profile of the light going in will be slightly shifted in this direction. In this case, the system variable is the which path indicator, that is clockwise or counterclockwise. The measuring device is the transverse displacement on return to the beam splitter. The pre-selection is the fact that the beam originated in port 1 rather than port 2, and the post-selection basically consists in detecting light only in the dark port 2. But you will have to detect it as a function of transverse displacement. And again, since the shift expected is very much smaller than the original width of the beam in this direction, that does constitute a weak measurement. Now, if you were to just do the experiment as shown there, it turns out you'd expect that the initial and final states were exactly exactly equal. You see, and in fact, you see, if you have a stationary SAGNAC interferometer properly set up, and you don't do any weak measurement, then you'd expect that you get nothing in the dark port at all. So that basically corresponds to these two states being orthogonal. However, you put in what they do is to put in a small phase shift by an extra device in these beams. A small relative phase shift, and you find then the weak value is 2i divided by phi. And the actual value of the weak value is something like 90 in this experiment. And they were able to use this setup to measure a minimum value of the slight displacement of the mirrors they could measure was something like 600 femtoradians, and they comment that this means, I don't quite understand the details of this setup, but they had a piezoelectric actuator, which apparently is something which has to do, a screw which has to move or whatever, and they comment that this this minimum measurable angle corresponds to a minimum measurable distance of something less than the diameter of a uranium nucleus, less than a femtometer, in fact. So it is, I think, quite impressive from that point of view. Well, as I say, so the effect, these peculiar properties of so-called weak measurement do at least have some very real practical application. But there's still a number of conceptually puzzling things about it. And let me finish off this lecture by going back to our old friend, the three-box problem, which has a further subtlety, I think. So you remember the setup. You have these three boxes, and a particle can be found in any one of these three boxes. What we're going to do, as before, is to prepare the initial state to be this symmetric linear superposition of states being in A, B, and C. And you're going to post-select with this state here. And then you're going to ask, what happens if we measure the state at some intermediate time? Well, first of all, just basically repeating results we got earlier. First, suppose we make a complete von Neumann measurement. That is, we set the... It's very important to be clear about what we mean by this. We're going to set up our measuring device so that it has three different outputs corresponding to A, B, and C. And these three outputs will be easily distinguishable at the macroscopic level. Now we can ask, okay, what are the probabilities involved? And it's rather straightforward to calculate these. The expectation value of a P sub A, which is the for a von Neumann measurement, is certainly the probability of finding it in state A, is a third. Probability in B is a third. Probability in C is a third. No problem. Very straightforward. Suppose now we make a weak so-called measurement. Then, as we already saw, we had a we found that the weak expectation value of P sub A was plus one, but so was the weak expectation value of P sub B. And moreover, the weak expectation value of P sub C is minus one. So they do add up to one appropriately. And that then is only a paradox if the measurement is interpreted as revealing some value for the system. That is, if you interpret this formal result as saying that the particle was definitely in box one, which I claim in general you're not entitled to do. However, there is a further subtlety, which is the original one pointed out by Aronoff and Weidmann. Suppose we make neither a complete von Neumann measurement, asking A or B or C, or a weak measurement, which in some sense doesn't really ask the question strongly at all. Suppose we make what you might call a semi-weak or partial von Neumann measurement. So what we're going to do now is to ask, ask the particle, are you in box A or not in box A? Are you in box B or not in box B, etc. Now, at this point, you have to think carefully about how to apply the theory of pre- and post-selected ensembles. The probability that you went from from the initial state phi to the final state chi via A is given by the probability that you went from phi to A and from A to chi. So that's no problem. What about the denominator here? You remember you had to divide by the total probability of going from phi to chi. Now, one possibility was to go through A, so you certainly get that term in the denominator. But now what about the possibility of going through B or C? Now you see you didn't make a measurement there. So So in some sense, it's as if the system had, if the system was not in state A, then it would have, it must be in the subspace of B and C. But if it was in the subspace of B and C, you didn't make a measurement on it at all. So the probability in question is simply the overlap of phi and chi all squared within that manifold. So more precisely, the projection of phi on B times B on chi plus phi on C, C on chi. Okay. So now that, if you stare at your expression here, that expression is zero. So in other words, there is no amplitude to, given that given that the system started in state phi, and given that you made a measurement at an immediate time and determined that it was not in A, therefore it must have been in a particular combination of B and C, but any no combination of B and C will give you anything other than zero for this. So this amplitude then, or this probability, is zero, and the probability of PA equal to 1 is just 1. So, now you see that at first sight at least, this is, I think, rather more surprising than what we had before, because your measurement was at least partially a proper von Neumann measurement. You did you're answering the question, are you in A or not in A? And you still found that if you asked that question, you always got the result, yes, I am in A. But of course, by symmetry, if you ask the question, are you in B or not in B, then again, the answer is going to be plus 1. So that really is, I think, rather more puzzling than the original, or, well, the simple weak measurement situation. And, well, you might like to think a little about that. You might like to think what you would get if you asked it, C or are you in C or not in C? Whether there's any real paradox in these results. And of course, needless to say, there have been a number of papers in the literature discussing whether or not there's a real paradox there. But it's certainly prima facie, I think, a rather amusing situation. Okay. So that was really what I wanted to cover in this lecture. And so I've been talking in this lecture about weak measurement in the context of pre- and post-selection. But there are, as I mentioned earlier, there are a lot of interesting applications of weak measurement without post-selection, and these particularly tend to occur in mesoscopic systems where the theory has been quite well developed, and I'll try to say a bit about that in the next lecture.